criticizing. Legalize.
Excuse me while I light my spirits. Oh God, I got to take a lift. From reality, I just can't drift. That's why I'm staying with this riff.
While majority of the world struggles to attain some sense of peace among their hectic and strained daily activities, Jamaica stands as the beacon of relaxation, leisure, and warmth among the population. For the most part, respect is reciprocated naturally on this little island. And the indigenous solutions to capitalist problems are acknowledged, practiced, and supported. Except, throughout Jamaica's history, there has been one gray area of confrontation surrounding a rather green area that flourishes culturally and geographically right here on this Caribbean island.
Yo. Finally, the herbs come around me. I quit with me, I look for me, get it by the phone, yeah. Sweet sensei, come around.
St. Elizabeth is one of the largest parishes in Jamaica, with Black River, the longest river in the island, over 10 beaches, and an abundance of fertile soil which gives way to the production of a vast majority of crops. This parish is undoubtedly a gem to many industries. One in particular is yet to be recognized legally. The illegal ganja industry is very much present in Jamaica. And St. Elizabeth is one of the biggest harbors of this trade. There are indeed many ganja farms in St. Elizabeth, despite ganja being illegal, except for medicinal purposes in Jamaica. But what contributes to this continuous disrespect for the law? The farmers of this illegal trade are well prepared to take the risk losing everything, including their freedom to interact with the rest of society. We spoke with a ganja farmer who lives and operates right here in the western part of the island.
We have money for different law and different thing. Mm-hmm. So if I find, we just pay with fine. If can't find, we just do on 6 months and no see our road again. Because our work, you know, to have a plan, prepare for everything.
So, you'd have, if you spend the time, you'd have come back on the same thing.
Yeah, right? Because I'm at work. You see me? I'm not going to really know this and go work for a guy. Because where he might give me care of me and my family. Because to my boss, I'm clean. You understand what I'm saying? I love clean. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Makes me fly with a visa. Don't give me comfort like a rug. Cigarette smoke is just no good. I am just a...
Sometimes they have teeth, we come teeth with them and thing. So sometimes with a circle we found like a night time. Like when them never come in like now. Mm-hmm. Like when we have the weed them up and up in there, we just come circle we found. So I show that is not properly because sometimes now when the next farm them, when we have a good matchash and thing, we sleep at the farm like reaping time.
Till me I redder than a PNP meeting. Smoke till me highlight the word where you use for your greeting. No breakfast eating, not even tea me not sweet. Straight beat me needing. My day no start till me frost. Sometimes.
But how do you differentiate good ganja from bad ganja?
You just walk and you search the field like a row to row. And you look on the sign then because you go see the sign like this.
Yeah.
If it is a muffadile. So you search. More time the muffadile come first underneath the bottom limb. Right, so you have to bend them like this and look and search them. You understand? Search them. Right? You have to bend them like this and look for the muffler dial and the man. So I said, search it and you find the male and know the male from the female. Like this, it's a male. This must go. Else you'll get seed.
So you
understand?
Throw them
on you? No, I can't throw them near the field because it will get giant blown. Enough man to spend the money and lose everything. You understand? Because the seed is very expensive. £1 a seed of $5,000.
Where get the seed from?
Alright, just like these now. Sometimes I breed my own seed. So sometimes I drop a little 3/4 seed, like, isn't it? Like say half of this.
Yeah.
And me make the powerful one them stay.
Mm-hmm.
And make them lick it up. Yeah. And you can spare and seed. That means your own seed can plant. Because sometimes them make these one, the man and the woman, lick in a deep seed.
The regular one.
Yeah, so too much work.
Yeah.
Because I have a search for this more. Mm-hmm. Because at this are the more danger. Because if you notice, this hard, this very hard to see. Mm-hmm. You have a skill to find
so
this, but this is easy to see.
Documentary and them are, well, I'm not even sure if they said this are the good one, but they did have a lot of this in them field. So I don't know.
No, you might say the purpose to them in the field, them good. But the sign is this not good because this is a male and female together.
Alright.
Because this is a sign. Male and female. Mm-hmm. So this will blow up the place. You understand?
Okay.
Yeah.
What are Kalalu?
Grabber. Tobacco. Grabber. Yeah.
Oh.
This is a grabber.
What kind of grabber that you're selling? Don't know red every. The road mistake no good. Papi tell you. Your name red rose. No money spending. Hot grabber for the blending. What kind of grabber that you're selling?
Okay, I've grabbed and
never everything. You understand?
Oh.
Yeah, so grab this.
How much?
This? Alright, this about a pound upon this now.
Okay.
About a pound of grabber. But me, you know, me normally plan to grab them to boil it and spray the weed. Like when the worm start to the worm them, I boil this because this applies, you know.
Spice the weed or the grabber can smoke?
No, grabber applies itself.
Yeah.
That's why the mark on cigarettes are smoking
kill.
Because this make cigarette and this poison.
Mm-hmm.
But just when it dry, it not poison again.
Okay.
But when it green, it poison.
Yeah.
Like now,
yeah.
If you boil it and drink it, it's poison. Dead.
Okay.
You understand? So me just boil this now and put them in a spray pan and spray the weed and kill the worm. Because there was a time when enough worm take them and eat them down. So you have to spray them and kill them.
You use fertilizer, you say?
Yeah.
Where you use grow them? Tell me where you use grow them.
Right. Weed now, like fertilizer and water and food plant. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
Just like these now, tomorrow now, I'm going to spray the food plant to make them come powerful, to make them buds start. You understand? So I'm going to get my spray pan now and walk and spray every tree.
Okay.
Listen to me. Sun and water mostly grow the weed, right? You have to water it like late evening and make it go throughout the night. And then in the next day, the sun come and burn it so it grow faster and more powerful. Like in scent and smoking, it burn more higher because the sun and it. That's why our sun now, it not high because the cool.
Okay.
Understand?
And a lot of it is grown indoors.
Indoors.
So them nagging.
Yeah, them nagging natural sun heat. But like this now, because as I can tell us, this is just month one.
Mm-hmm.
You see me by next month end, them a cut. You understand?
So I was about scenting weed.
Alright, and I really the weed, you know, are the seed.
Makes me fly with a visa. Don't give me cocoa like a rose. Cigarette smoke is just no good. I am just a...
So you see these seeds are normally $10,000 a pound for them seeds.
Mm-hmm.
But you're my virgin, you need me for $5,000. Alright? So
right.
These seeds now them are really pop, them are really popular. Everybody now want them because the strain of the weed high.
Okay.
You understand? So I have some little more seed now, so I breed it.
Oh.
And catch back the real strain of the plant back.
Oh, so the seed
and the seed and the breed of the seed.
So the potency.
You can't get 100 million seed and you can't grow no good weed with it.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the scent. And it's the seed. The good seed.
Mm-hmm.
That's why me know, no normally go out and buy a seed.
Yeah.
You see, me have to get special seed like these.
To grow good weed.
Because sometimes them sell a seed where all 200 of these in a hit. And sometimes you have to do too much work, too much bending, to try to find these. So sometimes you end up and get seed. But like this now, if you search the wall of it, you might be able to find three of these.
So you smoke?
No, and then. But not like for granted, like every man that goes shop and buy a spliff, no.
Tell me about some of the risks you have still as a planter.
Yes, yes, all right. Like, no. Sometimes some people pass and them say they go on and them don't like it. You see me? So we call that grudge or bad man, or where you want to put it. So them call police. I lose all. I have to start over from scratch again because enough beat me get. Enough time get cut down.
Police never hold you? Or them just come today?
No, them hold me because I ever look. You understand? But them normally come and hold me. Them come hold the weed and cut it down and burn it up.
You and your squad is trying to cut down all my herbs, evil trees, and let them live.
Yeah.
If we really look upon how much people in Jamaica, not just grow weed, but sell weed.
Yeah.
How much people you think, really? Even if they hide it.
Yeah, yeah, enough. But that's it. Me would say right now.
We have almost 3 million people.
Yeah, that's a good 1 million. Mm-hmm. I sell it.
This sentiment is shared by another avid user and smoker of the ganja plant.
You have more herbs up in a town, more than gas station.
So that, what you say?
You have more herbs up more than gas station. Let me tell you something.
In Kingston?
Yes, Kingston alone. I'm going to be precise. In West Kingston, I'm born and grow. If you don't see ganja, we'll put it in the school. Probably about 45% of West Kingston people who don't know a school door if you don't see ganja. You have mother. You know, some mother people put a dead out of prison. That's a runner town. You know, most woman have to walk parish to parish. The buy like this, come back at town, wrap it out in a little parcel like this. That's when little daughter pass, come on in, and can go to one little high school. All right. Me a freelance smoker. Me only not like me her front of the police. Me smoke it everywhere, anywhere. Evening time me come to work, me burn one from my yard, come right to work. Morning time me go home from work, I burn one from my workplace straight back in my yard. I go home, my bed and I go sleep. When I wake up, I build another one.
First thing I do when I wake up, when I get in the nurse pass, straight from West Banda Town bus, me have to smoke a pound fast.
So, even right now, I'm going to tell you what I have to say. Then we stop picking me. Can smoke herb, but not adult. And they must make sure the man who don't plant no herb, he mustn't sell any herb. He only can smoke herb, but he mustn't sell any herb when he don't plant herb. Because to do farming, you know, hands bite you, maca juke you, machete juke you. Dirt gets in your high and you sweat, you have to have your dirty hand and wipe out your high. And when we plant 1/4 acre of herb, the government can't do nothing for me. Send police and soldier come. And then reap it. And then burn the remnant. And the call the part of the money dependent take it for themselves. Tell them me, Samuel Kushley, say so. In the herb business long enough that we can confess it in front of anybody. When them burn down your herb field, and the remnant, the part where you call bush herb, and that burn, then carry the rest. Carry it away, and it come back from the field, come sell. All right. You know why the law no fit upon ganja? Eh? Me da jail. Me no say me da road, me da jail. And me burn ganja just like me da road. Me charge for ganja and da jail, and me burn the ganja same place as the jail. Mr. Mitch, look here, let me tell you something. You see, if it was for ganja, we are mad people like rice pan seashore. You see, in the institution, them, a ganja saved them. A ganja make up your mad woman and madman come back from prison. For them can't take the meditation and the dirty life of prison. So you see, when it comes on them, when the stress reaches them, eh? You see them start go so. And after them start go so, them light. And them take two draw. And the media that them take two draw, them think about something else harder than what them think about. So you see the wickedness where they overcome them right now. A different thing come over them. If they never get a place to smoke, it will be a judgment inside of the institution. They would have mad upon them one another. They would have war upon them one another.
Cultural analyst and director of the Institute of Caribbean Studies and the Reggae Studies Unit at UIMONA, Donna Hope, has spent majority of her life studying the Jamaican popular culture, including the use of marijuana among the population. For her, there is indeed an established ganja culture that transcends all social divides.
I did some research because from my work on dancehall and Jamaican music, I realized that we talk about certain parts of our music culture and carry on. You know, we talk about violence in dancehall and erotic sexuality, and we talk about reggae, you know, Rastafari and peace and love. But we never talk about this strong weed culture that the music tells us about in reggae, in dancehall, in rocksteady, even in some ska music. And so I went and did some research on this whole marijuana thing and looked at it as well through the lenses of the music. The use of marijuana, weed, herb, whatever term people call it, Kali, has been a part of the lives of Jamaicans from slavery. And they quarrel about who, we don't know who, they haven't decided on who really brought it here, whether it was it Africans or the endangered Indians. Nonetheless, it has been used for a very long time and has been used for many things, not just for smoking. It predated Rastafari. Rastafari came here, saw marijuana when they started the, you know, Rastafari in 1930s. So marijuana was illegal before Rastafarianism began. Because it was being used by the lower working class, black people, poor people, for various things. They smoke it, they boil it and make tea, they rub up with it. And so a lot of us, especially from rural Jamaica, were raised in communities and groups that marijuana was a part of life. It's not just men smoking it and going wild and aggressive, but they use it to help cure all kinds of illnesses. You have a flu, them give you some weed tea. You have cold, them give you some weed. You have asthma. So it's a part of our lives as Jamaicans.
But the Rastafarian community has kept the fire under the advocation as long as they have existed. Their blatant undermining of the laws might be the string that holds the cultural practice. Miguel Lorne, an attorney at law, as well as a Rastafarian, believes this is so.
So to fight Rasta, you fight ganja. Your more stringent the laws against ganja is more stringent against Rasta. So you couldn't come out and say you are cutting off this religion, but at least you could, in fighting Rasta, you use the ganja as an element. And by 1941 now, this is the first time now we start to see mandatory sentences against ganja. The legislators then started making it mandatory, so you are restricting the judges from having a discretion. In other words, once you are caught with X amount of ganja, the penalties 6 months or 12 months or 18 months, and we still start building up 1941 until by 1964 now, with Bustamante at the helm and the Coral Gardens incident just passed. And of course, ganja was blamed for Coral Gardens. Ganja was blamed for Rastas standing up for their land rights and so on. And so by 64 now, they made it further mandatory, 18 months minimum, if you are caught with even a spliff of ganja. And that continued from 1964 up until 1972, when Michael Manley became prime minister and, of course, took a more liberal stand towards ganja and removed the mandatory sentence by 1972. But, you know, they have, in my view, used ganja as a means to get at the bigger prize, which was to suppress Rastafari. That freedom, that liberation of mind was blamed on ganja. It might very well have been ganja that helped us to reach that higher heights and reach that level of unity and, you know, feeling liberated in ourselves.
Na, 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 na. Yeah.
For Dr. Hope Marquis, the advocation for ganja raises in unison voices that existed long before and beyond the Rastafarian faith.
The Rastafarians did not invent weed. So we had this discussion. When Rastafari developed in the 1930s, marijuana was already illegal. You see, if they decided to use something that was illegal on the books as their religious sacrament to overturn the Babylon system, it's like you turn the system on its head. Rastafarians said, well, our sacrament will be something that is already illegal because it was always being used. And so they took this illegal, and it's natural, it's a plant. And so they took this thing, put it into their old religious group and used Bible verses to talk about the value of it, because Rastafari draws from the Christian Bible, and also to make it a central part of their worship and their gatherings. And so it means it's a part of their meditative practices, a part of their grounding sessions, and it's a very important part of Rastafari culture and worldview. In terms of openly advocating, yes, they have been, because even while many Jamaicans have been using the plant and have been smoking it and selling it and using it in different ways, Rastafari have been the main advocates for the freeing up of the weed, the legalization of it, more legalization than even the decriminalization, legalization of it. They have been the main and consistent advocates.
Attorney at law Bert Samuels, although an agent of the same legal system which continues to make ganja use criminal, believes it is full time the system changes to acknowledge the cultural practice.
From a cultural point of view in Jamaica, part of the indigenous medicinal use of ganja has been for people with asthma and other ailments. But that cultural group, indigenous group, has not been recognized by our laws, because I have been in court for the last 35 years. And each time a person says, yes, I was found with this ganja, but I take it to make tea because I'm asthmatic, or I use it for other purposes, the court has refused those arguments by the indigenous Jamaicans and its use, and have found them to be criminally liable for being in possession. What it says is that we have criminalized and put scars upon the future of a lot of young people. When, if we want to deal with the question of drugs, the intelligent approach is to have public education on its benefits and its disadvantages in terms of abuse. You and I know that we can go and buy painkillers, you know, without prescription at a pharmacy or at a local store. And if we should take multiple painkillers, we'd end up in the hospital. So that there are many drugs that are available which are not illegal, which we know the dangers. If you drink too much rum, which is a drug, you could end up in the hospital. So the fact that there is this discrimination against ganja because its abuse can hurt you, why is there not tobacco illegal? Why is there not alcohol illegal? The answer to that, it is big monies are behind the tobacco industry and the alcohol industry. And they dictate, it seems, to our parliament that, you know, you're getting tax revenue from, you know, from tobacco and alcohol. So, you know, it's a lose-lose situation for the state and for the manufacturers. Now, it is that very state that has taken a moral position on another drug, which is a plant, which has not been, you know, manufactured, it has not been processed. Ganja used in Jamaica is not processed. Tobacco is processed, and nicotine is in it to cause you to be addicted. And alcohol, we all know, is a processed substance. So the only unprocessed substance is the one that is illegal.
Legalize it. Don't criticize it.
Look, what a lot of people don't read behind the lines to realize that the definition of ganja exempts ganja which is made or used for medicinal purposes. So I have been advocating for years, almost like the lone voice, to say that ganja is already legal in Jamaica. Because the law, the definition clearly says we exempt ganja, which is used and made for medicinal preparations and use. So this is why our folk aspect, the ganja law in terms of used for mixed with wine, mixed with rum, mixed with pimento seeds and so on to sap the baby forehead, to inhale for cold and flu and all of that, to rub the chest, to drink for asthma, has been legal for years. And I'm strongly advocating that. And this is not accidental. It shows that somewhere along the lines, our legislators were thinking of ganja being used locally as part of the culture. It's a skillful thing they did because they were under pressure at the time. It started from about 1913. And because Jamaica was a colony then, we had to follow whatever Britain ordered. So we needed some skillful legislators to follow Britain but nevertheless leave the door open for many of our use of ganja. So from about 1913, when the law was made, seeking to certainly abolish the cultivation of ganja and so on and using ganja. Because there is evidence that there were slaves who brought over ganja from Africa. There is evidence that the indentured Indians in and around the 1860s brought ganja from India and probably brought the name ganja, which you know it comes from the Ganges River, which is holy and sacred. So you have that historical connection, and there is evidence that in exploring, they would see where the Indians were using ganja normally in their daily work, in their daily chores, and selling it over the counter in their shops. So 1913 come up, then 1924 now, they started passing laws making the penalties more stringent and harsher. If you watch the pattern of 1924 with what went on in America, by the 1930s, when they had the Depression and Prohibition and all of that, so they put pressure on poor little Jamaica now to fall in line and started blaming ganja. You know, when persons turn up at the lunacy asylum, which is Bellevue, immediately when they're not thinking right, it's most ganja, and so on. And the corollary to all of that now, by the 1930s, with the rise of Rastafari, and with this rise, of course, is must ganja make people chatting the foolishness them chatting. Imagine, His Majesty's God. God is black. God lives in Africa. We are Africans. All of that talk must be ganja talk. That is not Christian talk. And so you started seeing articles coming out in the newspapers referring to us as South Rastafarians, as South Sea cannibals.
I can see the wicked
Jamaican popular music is largely a reflection of the social and cultural interactions that exist in the country. The music, more specifically reggae and dancehall, both express popular culture beliefs and values. Aggression and violence is often depicted. Polygamy and sexuality is widely promoted, and ganja holds great sacramental and recreational value to the creators and adherents of Jamaican popular music.
Because Jamaican music is not just dancehall, but Jamaican music is all the different genres. And what I have found is that, especially in reggae music, because of the strong Rastafari component, that you have had a lot of advocacy for marijuana, smoking marijuana, using marijuana as a sacrament, marijuana as meditative aid, marijuana as a natural plant, from a whole range of reggae artists. And we know Peter Tosh is famed for his own consistent stance, not just in terms of singing about it, but performing with marijuana openly in defiance of the state entities. And all of our artists, Bob Marley, Sky, you have Bob Marley, all of them have songs that legitimize the marijuana, that ask for it to be freed, that, you know, say to you that it is something good, it's a plant, free up the herb, and it is our sacrament, and Rastaman should be allowed to have it. Dancehall is a part of Jamaica, so the artists who are going to sing in dancehall are not coming from a different place from Rastafari, it's the same society. They smoke marijuana, some of them, and most of them have a song or several songs that talk about marijuana, or in their songs they will talk about the value of it, how good it is, it cures all ailments, and, you know, dancehall has more sex and sexuality, so they'll talk about eye grade and under McGuinness and eye grade thing. For example, they'll talk about that kind of thing. Give me weed, me good ganja weed.
Give me the weed, good ganja weed. Now man a burn it down, cause one will murder the weed.
And one of the things that dancehall has that is different from reggae is the rejection of cocaine in favor of marijuana. And that is as comes from when, because of when dancehall came onto the scene, and when the cocaine trade, the transshipment, started to really mark Jamaican society in a real way, where people saw the real effects in front of them of what cocaine did to human beings. And so dancehall coming up in that era, most of the artists, when they talk about marijuana, it's sometimes in a reverse. So you have Ninja Man, they'll talk about how the white lady mashup, you know, and they'll talk about that as kind of rejection of the damaging influences of cocaine, as opposed to the natural aphrodisiac meditative drug that is marijuana for Jamaicans. And it's a good thing, and they all talk about it, that it's a good thing. You know, it was found growing on King Solomon's grave, so you'll be wise. These are some of the things that they will see, and it's always seen as a good thing, always.
Sometimes the things you need in life may be difficult. Not all the time it's gonna be easy. I saw we go smoke the marijuana and get stay above.
The more you accept herbs, the more you accept Rastafari. You dig what I say? We who accept herb is important, but herb is more important to the people who don't accept it yet, because that is a reality. I mean, it's not Sevelin, Sevelin is something that you crave, but you check it in your sense and say, herb is a plant. I mean, herbs are good for everything. Why these people who want to do so much good for everyone, who call themselves governments and this and that, why them say you must not use the herb? You see? And we check that and we can't find, we just see them just say, no, you must use it because it make you rebel. Against what? Against men who won't crave, because them crave for the things like Sevelin. Them have some material things and them want to captivate your mind and tell you, say, well, you have to work and put you on pension and him keep it all. So herb make you look by yourself, and instead of you want to work for the man, you want to be one of the man too. Not in the sense of how he is, But in the sense that why should you have to bow to these things?
Do you have to smoke to be a Rasta?
No, man.
Marijuana is a natural herb that has been around for centuries and has been used for centuries. And it has multiple sides to it. The smoking side obviously has medicinal properties in it, and recreational, you know, uses too. Just like, you know, akin to like alcohol or somebody drinking. I don't drink alcohol. So, I mean, if I had a stressful day, you know, I can't take up a bottle of a beer and relax with a beer. I don't drink. I can't drink alcohol. And so the earth gave me something else. The earth gave me a plant. And everything on earth is here for a reason. There's nothing here that is not here for a reason. Every plant, every insect, every animal play a part. We also play a part. And so I think that people should not be demonized, and the plant should not be demonized.
This evening, the United States is reporting a reduction in the seizure and destruction of ganja and some related products in Jamaica.
The narcotics police have laid charges against four persons, including a woman, who were arrested last week in connection with a major ganja growing operation in the Old Stony Hill area of St. Andrew.
The man found it a spliff is always a male between the ages of 16 and 25.
Them not give a damn about poor people. Selfish capitalists they are. Selfish capitalists.
The International Narcotics Control Strategy Report is the United States government's country-by-country report that describes the efforts to attack all aspects of the international drug trade. Jamaica is one of 90 countries that have been highlighted. According to the report, Jamaica remains the largest Caribbean supplier of marijuana to the United States and local Caribbean islands. The report also makes mention of the efforts to destroy the plant and put a damper on the illegal practice. This was highlighted in Section 2 of the description. The police and military, supported by the United States, employed teams of civilian cutters to cut growing plants, seize seedlings, and cured marijuana and burned them in the field. Perhaps what is most staggering of the information is the idea that an estimated 15,000 hectares of marijuana is grown in all 14 parishes. That, stated differently, amounts to one-fifth of Kingston's size and merely 2% of Jamaica's agricultural land.
The stone that the builder refused will always be the head cornerstone. Sing it, brother. The stone that the builder refused.
How long is too long? Too long mean too little. Too little freedom. Too little profits. Hurry up, man. Hurry upward mobility. Hurry up and give back to the people what truly belongs to them. A long time Rasta talk to you, you know. A long, long, long time Rasta talk, you know. Una ready now? No, una ready.
Hear what I say. Stone that the builder.
A lot of this scientifically is now being proven. What in some situations, many people, you know, if you think in traditionally in Jamaica, you know, I remember my grand aunt, she was like 94 years old, and you know, she'd have her rum and her plants soaking, and you go and you take a little drop. So there's, you know, there's a lot of the culture and the history. What has changed now is we're now getting the science to prove what our forefathers knew, and that's, you know, that's a big difference in terms of medical marijuana right now.
Jamaica was the first country to have developed medicinal drugs from ganja. Medical marijuana is a U.S. term where they have allowed people who have certain conditions like the multiple sclerosis, severe pain, etc. They are allowed to have access to the marijuana, supposedly under very strict conditions. For the number of people who have been on it. I'm sure the restrictions have been expanded. And a lot of people who will come up with a lot of various disorders so as to get hold of it. It has proven to be extremely popular in Colorado, where it was legitimized recently. And the effect of it is it has brought it in from the criminal aspect into a situation where it is being taxed, and the state has derived tremendous benefit from it. From when I was president of the Medical Association in Jamaica in 2000, they had Professor Barry Chavans had a committee which looked at it, and our recommendation was that it should be allowed for personal use in small quantities and under certain restrictions, adults only, and it should not be smoked in the public. In other words, you not have somebody going into Halfway Tree and smoking and say it was legitimate. So when the confines of their homes are, as the Rastafarians are called, a sacrament, within the confines of their own place of worship, then they could share it, but it should only be with adults and not with children. Because there's some people, when they smoke it, they have a bad reaction, and they, you know, mentally, and they have used that as the example, but there's some people who have the same thing with alcohol. And that has been a traditional thing where ganja was classed as a very, very serious narcotic, you know, dangerous drugs. It does have certain, does affect the brain, and anything that affects the brain can cause problems.
It's now 2014, 66 years after the Dangerous Drugs Act was introduced. 66 years after many have been prosecuted for varying uses of ganja. It's the year that all Jamaica and cannabis stakeholders around the world could be greeted with news that lawmakers decriminalized ganja. When the smoke clears, one thing is certain. The social stigma and political limitations have hindered the medical research of the ganja plant. But the Jamaican government, however late, seems to be moving in the direction of ganja advocates.
The Dangerous Drugs Act is to be amended to make possession of small quantities of ganja for personal use a ticketable infraction. Possession of 2 ounces or 0.057 kilograms or less will become a non-arrestable, ticketable infraction, attracting a monetary penalty which shall be payable outside of the court system and which does not give rise to a criminal record.
The question now is, where will this move take us? And if it does take us somewhere, will we all benefit?
The potential economic benefits, and I don't want to quantify and say put this number on it, but if you attack it from two fronts, first of all, you're going to save those resources that you're expending for a purpose and a rationale that no one can really justify. If you ask someone, like, why are we going out and grabbing that young man, 16 years old, arresting him, giving him a criminal record, preventing him from ever traveling into the United States, preventing him if he becomes a musician, limiting, like, why are we doing it? Like, I don't think there's anyone that can give a rational answer for that. You've got the arrest, you've got the court system, you've got all the other economic consequences that follow. So immediately you're now reducing that. And then on the second part of it, once you start looking at the research and development and bringing products to market, you know, increasing the financial situation for the country. So it's a win-win all around. I don't see any negatives on either side. Excuse me while I light my spirits. Oh God, I got to take a lift. From reality, I just can't drift. That's why I'm staying with this riff. Take it easy. Lord, I take it easy. Take it easy. Got to take it easy. See?
The more you accept herbs, the more you accept Rastafari. You dig what I say? We who accept herb is important, but herb is more important to the people who don't accept it yet, because that is a reality. I mean, it's not Sevelin, Sevelin is something that you crave, but you check it in your sense and say, herb is a plant.